إِنَّ هَذَا الْقُرْآنَ يَهْدِي لِلَّتِي هِيَ أَقْوَمُ وَيُبَشِّرُ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ الَّذِينَ يَعْمَلُونَ الصَّالِحَاتِ أَنَّ لَهُمْ أَجْرًا كَبِيرًا.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. تبارك الذي جعل في السماء بروجا وجعل فيها سراجا وقمرا منيرا وهو الذي جعل الليل والنهار خلفة لمن أراد أن يذكر أو أراد شكورا. وعباد الرحمن الذين يمشون على الأرض هونا وإذا خاطبهم الجاهلون قالوا سلاما. والذين يبيتون لربهم سجدا وقياما. والذين يقولون ربنا اصرف عنا عذاب جهنم إن عذابها كان غراما. إنها ساءت مستقرا ومقاما. والذين إذا أنفقوا لم يسرفوا ولم يقتروا وكان بين ذلك قواما. والذين لا يدعون مع الله إلها آخر ولا يقتلون النفس التي حرم الله إلا بالحق ولا يزنون ومن يفعل ذلك يلقى أثاما. يضاعف له العذاب يوم القيامة ويخلد فيه مهانا إلا من تاب وآمن وعمل عملا صالحا فأولئك يبدل الله سيئاتهم حسنات وكان الله غفورا رحيما. ومن تاب وعمل صالحا فإنه يتوب إلى الله متابا. والذين لا يشهدون الزور وإذا مروا باللغو مروا كراما. والذين إذا ذكروا بآيات ربهم لم يخروا عليها صما وعميانا. والذين يقولون ربنا هب لنا من أزواجنا وذرياتنا قرة أعين واجعلنا للمتقين إماما. أولئك يجزون الغرفة بما صبروا ويلقون فيها تحية وسلاما. خالدين فيها حسنت مستقرا ومقاما. قل ما يعبأ بكم ربي لولا دعاؤكم فقد كذبتم فسوف يكون لزاما. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. وإنه لتنزيل رب العالمين. نزل به الروح الأمين على قلبك لتكون من المنذرين بلسان عربي مبين وإنه لفي زبر الأولين أولم يكن لهم آية أن يعلمه علماء بني إسرائيل ولو نزلناه على بعض الأعجمين فقرأه عليهم ما كانوا به مؤمنين كذلك سلكناه في قلوب المجرمين لا يؤمنون به حتى يروا العذاب الأليم فيأتيهم بغتة وهم لا يشعرون فيقولوا هل نحن منظرون أفبعذابنا يستعجلون أفرأيت إن متعناهم سنين ثم جاءهم ما كانوا يوعدون ما أغنى عنهم ما كانوا يمتعون وما أهلكنا من قرية إلا لها منذرون ذكرى وما كنا ظالمين وما تنزلت به الشياطين وما ينبغي لهم وما يستطيعون إنهم عن السمع لمعزولون فلا تدع مع الله إلها آخر فتكون من المعذبين وأنذر عشيرتك الأقربين واخفض جناحك لمن اتبعك من المؤمنين فإن عصوك فقل إني بريء مما تعملون وتوكل على العزيز الرحيم الذي يراك حين تقوم وتقلبك في الساجدين إنه هو السميع العليم هل أنبئكم على من تنزل الشياطين تنزل على كل أفاك أثيم يلقون السمع وأكثرهم كاذبون والشعراء يتبعهم الغاوون ألم تر أنهم في كل واد يهيمون وأنهم يقولون ما لا يفعلون إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وذكروا الله كثيرا وانتصروا من بعد ما ظلموا وسيعلم الذين ظلموا أي منقلب ينقلبون
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Tabarak is He who has created the creation and enacts predestination merely with the command, Be. He it is who alternates the night and the day and causes the sun and the moon to orbit in perfect harmony. He has sent down to us a book that is our cure and guidance, a speech that is revealed divinely. And He has chosen to make us amongst the Ummah of the best of His creation, whom we believe in with full certainty. We ask Him that we be of the righteous, so that we may enter His paradise to live for all of eternity. Today, inshallah ta'ala, we'll be doing Surah Al-Furqan. And we're going to be starting off talking about this beautiful surah. And I say this is one of my favorite surahs, and then somebody comments, but you said it about so many other surahs. And I reply, you know, honestly, and I'm not just saying this, that every single surah has a special place, you know, in the heart of every hafiz, everybody who reads it. And for me, Surah Al-Furqan is a very, very beautiful surah in its own way. And then when we get to the next surah, I'll say the exact same thing. Surah Al-Furqan, it is a late Makki surah. And the primary purpose of this surah is to glorify Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to affirm the prophethood of our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And one of the major sub-themes of this surah is to describe the creation, describe the characteristics of the worshippers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the name of the surah comes from the word al-Furqan, which means the criterion. And the criterion or the Furqan is one of the names of the Quran. The Quran is called many names in the Quran. You have the Quran, you have the Kitab, and then you have the Furqan, then you have the Hudan, the Shifa, the Maw'idah. All of these are names of the Quran. And the word Furqan means that which separates truth from falsehood. So the Quran is what you turn to separate truth from falsehood. Surah Al-Furqan is a mid-sized surah. It's around 7 pages. And one of its most famous passages is the final page, page and a half, that describes very beautifully around a dozen characteristics of the servants of Ar-Rahman. And this surah is one of only two surahs in the whole Quran that begins with the phrase Tabarak. Of course, the more famous surah that begins with Tabarak is Surah Tabarak. That Tabarak alladhi biyadi al-mulk. But this surah begins Tabarak alladhi nazzala al-furqana ala abdihi. That Tabarak be the one who has sent down the Furqan, hence the name of the surah, upon his servant. And the word Tabarak, it is very rare in the Quran. It actually only occurs 9 times in the entire Quran. 3 of those 9 times are in Surah Al-Furqan. So 1/3 of the times that the word Tabarak occurs, it is in this blessed surah. And the word Tabarak, it means that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is himself exalted in every manner above the creation. It means that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the source of all good. All good comes from the one who is Tabarak. It means that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the source of all blessings, Barakah. And blessings means that anything of a small quantity or any time frame of a small amount, it is made to feel like it is much more. And so imagine this glass of water, if it had barakah, it would feed not just one person, but 100 or 1,000 people. Time, if time has barakah, instead of accomplishing a certain amount in an hour, if you have barakah, you will accomplish much more. So that's what barakah means. Tabarak, the source of barakah. Where does barakah come from? In English we say, where does blessings come from? So the word tabarak means that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most exalted and supreme. There is no entity that is more exalted than him. And tabarak is the one who is the source of all good. And tabarak is the one who blesses. It is with his name that things are blessed. It is by mentioning his name that something becomes blessed. That is tabarak. So tabarak is the one who has sent down the criterion upon his servants, and this his servant, meaning the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And this surah, it begins by challenging, listing one by one the reasons that those who rejected Islam, why did they reject Islam? They took false gods, and Allah says these gods, not only did they not create anything, they themselves are created, right? لَا يَخْلُقُونَ وَهُمْ يُخْلَقُونَ. These gods are not creators. You have to carve them out. You have to create them. They claimed that the Prophet ﷺ, أعوذ بالله, he is lying against Allah. They claimed that he is quoting أَسَاطِيرُ الْأَوَّلِينَ. And أَسَاطِير is an Arabicized word that is based in another Latin word from which we get the English story and history. أَسَاطِير is literally stories, the same root word. In English, it goes back to a root word, and the Arabic also goes back to that root word. So they say that he is quoting asatir, stories of the people of old that he copied. They say that he is a normal man. يَمْشِي فِي الْأَسْوَاقِ يَأْكُلُ الطَّعَامِ. He's eating and drinking. He's going in the supermarkets and the normal bazaars. How can he be a prophet? Why didn't they send an angel? And Allah Azza wa Jalla then replies to each one of these points one by one. For example, in verse 20, that we have never sent any messenger before you, illa annahum ya'kuluna at'ama wa yamshuna fil aswaq, except that they would eat food and they would eat in and they would walk in the bazaars. Prophets are human. They eat, they drink, they buy, they marry, they have children. They are normal human beings. They're flesh and blood. And then Allah Azza wa Jalla says, وَجَعَلْنَا بَعْضَكُمْ لِبَعْضٍ فِتْنَةً أَتَصْبِرُونَ, and we made some of you as temptations for others. We made some of you as a test and trial for others. Will you be patient? And indeed, your Lord is ever watching. This phrase, we made some of you as tests for others, it is so profound. Of course, the Quranic message is very clear that the point is that we have made the prophets a test for their followers and the followers are a test for their prophets. This is the context of the verse. However, the verse, and this is the beauty of the Quran, you can extrapolate so many meanings. Even though the original context was something, you have the scholar of the tafsir has the right to extrapolate so many more meanings. And this verse is a beautiful verse that applies to every one of us. We have made groups of you to be temptations for other groups. There is no person on earth except that you will have problems with somebody and people are going to have problems with you. There's no person on earth except that there's going to be issues, frustrations, the problems that are going to happen. And this is a verse we need to remind ourselves of. We have made groups amongst you to be tests for other groups. Believers are tests for those who persecute them. Those who persecute them are being tested with the believers as well. That rich people are a type of test to the poor, that the poor will see them and they're going to feel things in their hearts. Vice versa as well. The poor are a test for the rich. Will the rich genuinely be humble? Will they give unto the poor? The people that are healthy are a test for those that are sick. People that are sick are a test for those that are healthy. Sometimes, even men are tests for women. Women are tests for men. Every single group of people, every individual, there are others out there, there are tests for him. And no person is saved from being tests for other people as well. Just like you find someone irritating, it is guaranteed somebody also finds you irritating as well. Allah is saying, we made groups amongst you to be tests for other people. Why? أتصبرون. Are you going to act with patience? Will you act the way that you're supposed to act? And then remember, وَكَانَ رَبُّكَ بَصِيرًا. Your Lord is ever watchful. He is watching all that you do. Next time you're in a situation that is a bit of a test for you, remember this verse. And remember, Allah is testing you to see if you will be patient. And remember, Allah is watching. وَكَانَ رَبُّكَ بَصِيرًا. Allah is watching exactly what you do. Do you pass that test or not? And by the way, anytime you're in a test with somebody else, make sure you are the better of the two for the sake of Allah. Then the surah moves on and talks about those who deny the Day of Judgment. And it describes what's going to happen to those who are resurrected and those who are going to meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and they're going to meet the people on the Day of Judgment. Allah Azza wa Jalla says that on that day, the sky itself is going to be cleft asunder with clouds, and the angels are going to be coming down in streams. On that day, al-mulku yawma idhin ar-rahman. On that day, sovereignty and the kingdom will belong to Ar-Rahman, and it will be a very difficult day for those who rejected Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Verse 27, يَوْمَ يَعَضُّ الظَّالِمُ عَلَى يَدَيْهِ يَقُولُ يَا لَيْتَنِ اتَّخَذْتُ مَعَ الرَّسُولِ سَبِيلًا يَا وَيْلَتَى لَيْتَنِي لَمْ أَتَّخِذْ فُلَانًا خَلِيلًا. On that day, the wrongdoer will be biting his own hands and saying, oh, woe to me, if only I had followed the messenger. Woe to me, how I wish I had never followed so-and-so. How I wish I had never followed that person and taken him as a mentor and a role model. He is the one who led me away from the message after it had come to me. And indeed, shaitan is the one that betrays mankind. And the Prophet will say, وَقَالَ الرَّسُولُ يَا رَبِّ, oh my Lord, my people have abandoned the Qur'an. This section shows us two things. Anybody who does not take the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam as a role model, anybody who abandons the Quran will regret it on the Day of Judgment. Anyone who abandons the Quran and does not take our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam as the ultimate role model, they shall regret it on the Day of Judgment. So we need to ask ourselves, Who is our role model? I mean, seriously, not just a question that's just passing. Think about it. Who do you really want to be? Who do you really look up to in the depths of your heart when you're daydreaming, when you're thinking about somebody you want to be like? Who is it that you're really aspiring to follow? And if it's not the Prophet ﷺ, then why? I mean, why? Don't you want to be in his company? Why have any regrets? Make him the ultimate role model and follow him and study his life. And then inshaAllah ta'ala, maybe, just because of that intention, we might be in the vicinity of the one whom we took as a role model. Because, dear Muslims, the last thing that we want to do is to take the wrong role model and then be resurrected with that role model. And then we have regrets and say, why did I take this person as the person I looked up to? Don't look up to anybody except those who are genuinely worthy to look up to. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then mentions in passing very quickly the Prophet Musa alayhi salam, the peoples of Ad and Thamud. Just the lines here and there. It's not a long story over here in Surah Al-Furqan. And he reminds mankind of the blessings that they have been given. The blessings of this world, the blessings of the sun, even the shade. Allah says, haven't you seen the shade? The blessings of the shade even. The blessings of the night and day, the blessings of the breeze that blows, the blessings of the rains that fall. And then verse 54, that هو الذي خلق من الماء بشرا. He is the one that has created from fluid, from water, he has created man. And from this man that he has made nasaban wa sihra, he has made family both by blood and through marriage. Verily your Lord is indeed omnipotent. SubhanAllah, again a beautiful reference here to family. That he has made families both by blood and by marriage. What a beautiful way to describe the family concept, that two people come together, a husband, wife come together. But it's not just those two people, the families form relationships. Your children, they have blood relatives that are not your blood relatives. Your spouse's blood relatives are your children's blood relatives. So Allah is saying this beautiful life and this beautiful society, this beautiful network of families, this is all from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's blessings. These friendships that are created, families are bonded together. Allah Azza wa Jalla is saying, I am the one that has done all of this. And then after mentioning all of these blessings, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then says, وَإِذَا قِيلَ لَهُمْ اسْجُدُوا لِلرَّحْمَنِ قَالُوا وَمَا الرَّحْمَنِ. When it is said to them to prostrate and to thank Ar-Rahman, they reject and they say, who is Ar-Rahman? And they say, we're not going to prostrate to Ar-Rahman. And this is because some segments of the Quraysh, they refused to accept the name of Allah, Ar-Rahman. They refused to accept the name of Allah, Ar-Rahman. And so they rejected Ar-Rahman. And Allah Azza wa Jalla tells us that whoever rejects one of his names has rejected all of his names. Allah Azza wa Jal has many names. 99 of them are extra special, but Allah has an infinite number of names, not just 99. And of those names is Ar-Rahman. In fact, Ar-Rahman comes in the list right after the name Allah itself. And the Quraysh rejected it. So Allah is saying, when they're told after all of these blessings, be thankful to Ar-Rahman, they reject Ar-Rahman. And then they refuse to prostrate because they refuse to prostrate. This is one of the verses of prostration in the Quran, that when it is recited in Arabic, it is strongly encouraged for us to demonstrate that we are thankful to Allah. And so this surah is one of the surahs that has the sajda or the prostration. After mentioning all of these blessings, Allah says, why don't they prostrate? Then we show Allah in our actions, not just in our recitation. We show Allah in our actions that we are going to prostrate, O Allah, after acknowledging all of these blessings. Then the last page and a half of the surah. And as I said, this last page and a half, it is very popular in recitation, and it also begins with تبارك الذي جعل في السماء بروجا. So again, this section begins also with تبارك. It's the last page and a half, just like the surah began with تبارك. In the middle of the surah, there's one more phrase of تبارك, and then in the end of the surah as well, the last two paragraphs as well, it goes تبارك. Verse 61, that blessed is he. And remember, what does تبارك mean? From now on, always memorize it. تبارك means that Allah is the one who is exalted and holy. All good comes from him. He is the source of blessings. He himself is blessed, and he is the source of blessings. This is what Tabarak means. There is no entity that is more blessed, more holy, more sacred than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So, Tabarak alladhi ja'ala fis sama'i burujan. Blessed is he who has placed constellations in the stars and place therein a lamp, meaning the sun, and an illuminating moon. And وَهُوَ الَّذِي جَعَلَ اللَّيْلَ وَالنَّهَارَ خِلْفَةً لِمَنْ أَرَادَ أَنْ يَتَذَكَّرَ أَوْ أَرَادَ شُكُورًا. He has made the night and the day alternating for whoever desires to reflect, whoever sees the miracle, and also whoever desires to show gratitude. SubhanAllah, the alternation of the night and day is such a constant theme throughout the entire Quran, and yet still how few of us even think about it. We just take it for granted. Can you imagine if we didn't have the night and day, what would happen? And so we really need to think about these verses of the Quran, that Allah Azza wa Jalla has made this creation, this 24-hour cycle, the alternation of the night and day, in perfect sync. All of this He has done for us. It is for us that this whole creation has been created. سَخَّرَ لَكُمْ. He has subjugated it for us so that we can reflect and thank and then give our gratitudes in the rituals and worship and in our interactions with others. Then Allah begins from verse 63 to the end. And please read this section of Surah Al-Furqan. That وَعِبَادُ الرَّحْمَانِ الَّذِينَ يَمْشُونَ عَلَى الْأَرْضِ هَوْنًا. The servants of Ar-Rahman, the real servants of Ar-Rahman. We are and we want to be the servants of Ar-Rahman, the worshippers of Ar-Rahman. They are those who walk with humility on this earth. And when the ignorant address them, when those of little morals address them, they say, peace, salam. Notice, in this long list, there's going to be like a dozen characteristics that are mentioned. The number one characteristic is what? Humility. The number one characteristic is their mannerisms with those that lack good manners. SubhanAllah, I've said it before, I'll say it again. If you don't display good manners with the creation of Allah, you are not a worshipper of Allah. This is what the Quran is saying. Read the Quran. وَعِبَادُ الرَّحْمَانِ الَّذِينَ يَمْشُونَ عَلَى الْأَرْضِ هَوْنًا. You cannot get more explicit than this. You want to be of the Ibadur Rahman, don't you? I want to be. Don't you want to be of those who worship Allah and are the servants of Allah? The servants of Ar-Rahman are those who display humility in front of everybody. And when somebody comes and wants to be harsh or mean, shows nastiness, and subhanAllah, the world is full of nasty people, and the world is full of people with bad akhlaq, Muslims and non-Muslims. This is the reality. The world is full of people who have an ego or personal issues, whatever it might be. What is the response of the Ibadur Rahman? Do they stoop to their level? Do they get involved? Do they speak in vulgarities when they are spoken to in vulgarities? Do they use curse words? Not at all. وَعِبَادُ الرَّحْمَنِ الَّذِينَ يَمْشُونَ عَلَى الْأَرْضِ هَوْنًا وَإِذَا خَاطَ. When the jahil, when the ignoramus, when the foolish person confronts them, what do they say? Salam, peace. I don't need to fight with you. I wish you all the best and whatnot. And let it go. SubhanAllah. What a beautiful akhlaq. We are constantly told to better ourselves. And subhan, you know, an interesting thing, brothers and sisters, is that when we employ this characteristic, in fact, we will gain the hearts and the minds of so many of these foolish people. These foolish people, they want to look for a fight. So when you fight, then they will win because they're more foolish than you. Their experience in foolishness is more than yours. So when you resort to their level, they will overcome you. But if you maintain your ground, maintain the higher moral ground, maintain your akhlaq and adab, eventually the sincere amongst them will come to you. And this is the sunnat Allahi fi khalqihi. It is the reality of Allah's dealings that He has told us to do, and we see its impact in this world. So this is the first characteristic that is mentioned. And again, I'm not going to go over the whole list because it is too long for our quick summary, but please do read it. And other things are mentioned as well. It lists the night prayer, by the way. It lists those who pray at night, and this is Salat al-Tahajjud. And again, the reason why the Quran emphasizes this night prayer, it is a reality that we're all familiar with, that the one who prays in the middle of the night, the one who wakes up and prays at that time frame, for sure, he is going to be praying the other prayers. For sure, he's going to, or she's going to have that level of taqwa and God consciousness. So what the night prayer does is that it really ups the game in your own life. If you're going to wake up when everybody's asleep in the middle of the night and it's just you and Allah and you're just praying to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you will automatically develop a level of consciousness that will benefit you throughout the day and night. And that is why there's so much of an emphasis on the night prayer. And so if you want to be from the true, the elect of the ibad al-Rahman, then there should be a dosage of the night prayer. And may I remind myself and all of you that, you know, perhaps some of us cannot pray the night prayer every single night. You know, praying it once a week is better than never praying it at all. So suppose it's the weekend and you don't have to go to work at 7, 8 a.m. Maybe that day that you will then wake up, you can pray an hour or two, make it that regular habit. Once a week, once a month, once every few weeks. I mean, some night prayers are better than none. So I advise myself and all of you that let's put this habit into our lives and just begin even a little bit, just semi-regularly, just begin a little bit so that inshallah ta'ala, we can taste the sweetness of this night prayer. And Allah Azza then mentions that these, the ibad al-Rahman, are those who avoid the major sins like murder, like fornication. And Allah Azza wa Jal says, but if anyone who does a major sin then repents, then that is not a problem. Allah Azza wa Jal accepts the repentance. And subhanAllah, always Allah allows a way out for the sinner. There's always hope in Allah. There's always a way to come back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then Allah praises the people. Again, all of these are characteristics. Go read them in the last section of the surah. That وَإِذَا مَرُّوا بِاللَّغْوِ مَرُّوا كِرَامًا. When they pass by frivolous matters, and frivolous matters means so many things. It could be an issue of haram entertainment. It could be an issue of people backbiting or gossiping. It could be anything that is of no value. They pass by with dignity. They pass by and they don't get involved in something that is just not befitting of the servants of Ar-Rahman. And one of the characteristics as well of the servants of Ar-Rahman is that they are eager to listen to the Quran. وَإِذَا ذُكِّرُ بِأَتِ رَبِّهِمْ لَمْ يَخِرُوا عَلَيْهِ صُمًّا وَعُمْيَانًا. That whenever the verses of the Quran are recited, they are not deaf and blind. They want to pay attention. And therefore, one of the signs of the servants of Ar-Rahman is that they want to study the Quran. They want to gain Islamic knowledge. And one of the signs as well, and this is one of my personal favorites of the whole Quran, this verse over here, and I'll confess this is one of my du'as as well, and should be all of our du'as all the time, is verse 74, that one of the characteristics of the ibad al-Rahman are, وَالَّذِينَ يَقُولُونَ رَبَّنَا هَبْ لَنَا مِنْ أَزْوَاجِنَا وَذُرِّيَاتِنَا قُرَّةَ أَعْيُنٍ وَجْعَلْنَا لِلْمُتَّقِينَ إِمَامًا. That they say that, O our Lord, give us our spouses and children that will be a comfort of our eyes, a coolness for our soul. We want families that are going to be peaceful for us. رَبَّنَا هَبْ لَنَا مِنْ أَزْوَاجِنَا وَذُرِّيَاتِنَا قُرَّةَ أَعْيُنٍ وَجَعَلْنَا لِمُتَّقِينَ إِمَامًا. And make us a good example for the righteous. We want to be the imam of the muttaqeen. What does it mean to be the imam of the muttaqeen? People of piety should look and say, oh, this is the person that I want to be like. See, we want to be positive role models. We ask Allah to be positive role models. We don't want to be negative. We don't want to be negative role models. We want to be beacons of virtue. We want people to be inspired by us so that inshallah ta'ala, all of us can become better and all of us can collectively gain good deeds so that we can present in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so this is a beautiful dua that we want to be paragons of virtue. We want to be wherever we go, people that are spreading good and love of this religion. That's our goal. We want to be imams for the muttaqeen. And subhanAllah, Allah is spoon feeding us this dua. Don't you think when we say it over and over and over again that Allah will accept it? He's the one handing us this dua. It's like a halal cheat sheet. This is the dua. Go ahead and say it. He's the one giving it to us. Don't you think Allah will then give what we are asking for when he's the one telling us how to ask? So the of the characteristics of the ibad al-Rahman, and this comes at the very end, by the way, which shows us once again that if you want good children and you want to be an imam for the muttaqeen, then all of these characteristics that have preceded, make sure you follow them in your daily life. And so those people who follow all of this, أُولَٰئِكَ يُجْزَوْنَ الْغُرْفَةَ بِمَا صَبَرُوا. These people shall be given the chamber. The غُرْفَة here means the VIP. The غُرْفَة here means the highest, the elite. You know, this is the high level because they were patient. وَيُلَقَّوْنَ فِيهَا تَحِيَّةً وَسَلَامًا. and they will be greeted therein with greetings and peace. حَسُنَتْ مُسْتَقَرًّا وَمُقَامًا. It is indeed a perfect abode, an excellent residence, and they shall live in it forever. And then Allah Azza wa Jal concludes this surah with a very powerful verse. قُلْ مَا يَعْبَأُ بِكُمْ رَبِّي لَوْلَا دُعَاءُكُمْ فَقَدْ كَذَّبْتُمْ فَسَوْفَ يَكُونُ لِزَامًا. Say, Allah Azza wa Jal would have no concern for you, O people of the Quraysh, O people who have rejected Him, were it not for the fact that you make dua to Him. Were it not for the fact that even occasionally you turn to Him, otherwise Allah would have no concern because of what you have done. And this is an amazing verse that the Quraysh, despite their idolatry, despite their rejection of the Prophet ﷺ, despite their persecution of the believers, when they showed even 1%, you know, religiosity, at times, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, because of that dua, because of that religiosity, at least you are still around. Allah is not sending His punishment on you, but still Allah is saying you have rejected. That religiosity will not save you in the hereafter, that 1%, because for Allah, you need to submit completely to Allah and accept Islam. But now that you have rejected, then the inevitable will follow, which means the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So, point here. If the kuffar of the Quraysh, Allah is allowing them to flourish and sustain because of their partial dua, then how much more so for us, inshaAllah ta'ala, who are believers in Allah? Shouldn't we increase our dua? Shouldn't dua be the core of our worship? How much will Allah love us and care about us the more that we make dua? So this is one of those verses that proves that dua is indeed one of the lifelines that we have to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The next surah we're going to do is Surah Al-Shu'ara. And today we'll do two surahs. From tomorrow, by the way, for the next like week or so roughly, we'll be doing three surahs. And then obviously we'll be increasing as we get closer to the end. But today is the last day. We'll be only doing only two surahs. Surah Al-Shu'ara. And Surah Al-Shu'ara, it is an early Meccan surah. And it is a very rhythmic surah, extremely rhythmic. The verses are very powerful, they're short, they're repetitive, the style is indicative of the early Meccan style, and in fact, in terms of verse numbers, it is one of the longest surahs of the whole Quran in terms of verse numbers. 227 verses, even though in terms of size, it is a mid-sized surah, around 10 pages, half a juz. But the verses are very, very small. And again, I say this surah is also one of my favorite, but listen to this surah. Find a qari that you like and listen to Surah Al-Shu'ara, because again, the verses are just powerful. And as well, it has a famous repetitive verse. It has a rhyming sequence or a repetitive verse. Around 7 or 8 times in the surah, it is repeated. إِنَّ فِي ذَلِكَ لَآيَةٌ وَمَا كَانَ أَكْثَرُهُمْ مُؤْمِنِينَ وَإِنَّ رَبَّكَ لَهُوَ الْعَزِيزُ الرَّحِيمُ. This is a repetitive sequence that the surah has many stories in it, and between every story, this line is repeated. Indeed, in this story are many signs, yet most of them did not believe. And truly, your Lord is full of power and all wise. So this is repeated multiple times between the stories. This surah as well is the first surah, when we're going through the Quran, it is the first surah to begin with the phrase, Ta-seen. And in this surah, Ta-seen meem. The next surah, Naml, will be Ta-seen. And then the surah after this, Qasas, Ta-seen meem. There are only three surahs in the whole Quran that begin with Ta-seen. Two of them, Ta-seen meem. And in the middle, Ta-seen. So memorize this simple fact here, that Surah Al-Shu'ara, and then Surah Al-Naml, and then Surah Al-Qasas. Shu'ara, Naml, and Qasas. These are the only three. Some have called them, these are the Tawaseem surahs, the surahs of Ta-seen. The first and the third, Ta-seen meem. And the middle one, only Ta-seen. And as we said, these are letters that only Allah knows what they mean, but most likely they're an indication of the miraculous nature of the Quran. And the entire surah, the bulk of the surah, 95% of the surah is stories. It just dives into the story and it continues all the way to the very end of this surah, but there are many multiple stories. And it begins with the story of Musa. Musa's the longest story from verse 10 to verse 68. And again, somebody asked on Twitter, why is there so much repetition in the Quran? And again, the response very briefly, firstly, there's no actual repetition. There's always something different. Secondly, every time Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brings a different time of the story, there will be a new factor, a new twist that is not in the other one. Thirdly, the wordings are so different that each one presents a different facet. You feel different even language-wise. Fourthly, in this repetition of the concept, there is the striking of the point over and over again. That if you're not going to learn the first time, maybe the second time you'll learn. If you're not going to learn the second time, maybe it is the third time. So there's no actual repetition that is useless. Repetition is for multiple reasons. And in this section of Musa, and we've done the story of Musa 10 times maybe by now, but in this section, again, there's unique things that are not mentioned in any other surah. So for example, in verse 18, Fir'aun says to Musa, قَالَ أَلَمْ لُرَبِّكَ فِينَا وَلِيدًا وَلَبِثْتَ فِينَا مِنْ عُمُرِكَ سِنِينَ, that didn't we raise you up as a child in our palace, and you spent so many years amongst us, وَفَعَلْتَ فَعْلَتَكَ الَّتِي فَعَلْتَ وَأَنْتَ مِنَ الْكَافِرِينَ, and yet you did the deed that you did, meaning you killed the Egyptian. You did the deed that you did, and you were from the kafirin. By the way, look at the irony. Fir'aun is calling Musa a kafir. A'udhu billah. How these people work, how it is. Fir'aun is calling Musa that you are from the kafir, but here he means you are the most ungrateful person. Don't be surprised when the enemies of Allah use the most abject lies and the most brutal slanders, when they call you the worst of the worst, and they are guilty of it. Fir'aun was the worst kafir in human history, and he is calling Musa the Kalimullah. You are from the kafirin. This is the reality of the enemies of Allah, how they will distort and how they will change the truth. So Fir'aun taunts Musa and says, you are coming back to me as a prophet after we did favors upon you, and we raised you, and you murdered one of us, and now you're going to come to me as a prophet. And so Musa responds, قَالَ فَعَلْتُهَا إِذَنْ, I did it, you're right. وَأَنَا مِنَ الضَّالِّينَ, and I was mistaken. And then Musa says, وَتِلْكَ نِعْمَةٌ تَمُنُّهَا عَلَيَّ أَنْ عَبَّدْتَ بَنِي إِسْرَائِيلَ, and is this favor that you're going to taunt me with any comparison that you have enslaved the entire race of the children of Israel? Subhanallah, what a beautiful message we learn. Musa made a mistake. Fir'aun brings up that mistake. Musa does not cover up. Musa does not become defensive for his own mistake. He acknowledges it. He goes, you know, you're right. I did that mistake. It was a mistake. And then he takes on the challenge. What right do you have to make this an issue that you took care of me in light of the fact that you have subjugated and enslaved hundreds of thousands of people? You have killed babies. You have done so much wrong. And now you're going to remind me that you took care of one person? Who are you to bring up any good that you have done only to me? So subhanAllah, this is the prophetic way. You don't cover up your faults. We all have our faults here. Musa made a mistake. But then that was a mistake. What you are doing, O Pharaoh, is an intentional evil. There's no justification for that. Then what follows is a beautiful back and forth that Fir'aun says, what is this concept of Rabbul Alameen? I thought I was the Lord of the worlds. And Musa says, the Lord of the worlds is the Lord of the heavens and earth and all that is between them, if only you knew. And Fir'aun says, look around, look at this person. And Musa says, he is your Lord and the Lord of your ancestors. And Fir'aun says, look, this person is crazy. Then Musa says, he is the Lord of the East and the West and everything between them, if you only understood. And then Fir'aun says, if you accept any God other than me, I will throw you into prison. Subhanallah. Look at the 3 degrees here. Look at the 3 degrees that Pharaoh went from point A to point B to point C. How does he begin? By mocking. That doesn't work. What does he do then? Slandering. The guy's crazy. That doesn't work. What does he do then? Retorts to threatening with force, with jail, with torture, with death. And this is the methodology of the pharaonic followers. You begin by making fun of people. That doesn't work? Okay, start the false accusations. Slur them. Throw bad adjectives at them. That doesn't work? Solid arguments are not going to work for the truth. People who are trying to fight the truth cannot fight the truth with intellectual arguments. What must they do? They resort to mockery and snide remarks. They resort to labeling. They resort to bad adjectives and accusations. When that doesn't work, they resort to force. They resort to laws. They're going to ban the hijab. They're going to call, you know, say mosque cannot be built, or they're going to throw, you know, people, Muslims in jail or whatnot. And subhanAllah, we have to mention here that we live at a time, may Allah Azza wa Jal protect all of us, so many righteous people, so many scholars around the globe, they have been jailed by tyrannical regimes simply for speaking the truth. Because people who are not upon the truth, they cannot intellectually engage. So when a scholar comes, when an alim comes and challenges a tyrannical regime, points out something wrong, they have no resort other than kill and subjugate and throw into jail. This is the methodology of Fir'aun, not the methodology of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So we make dua for all those that are jailed, and especially our Muslim brothers and sisters across the globe that are being tortured for no reason other than for saying La ilaha illallah. So back to our story here, that we see here as well the trust that Musa had in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Verse 61, فَلَمَّا تَرَى الْجَمْعَانِ, when the two groups, so Fir'aun is now chasing Musa and the Israelites, and Musa is now running for freedom, and they're fleeing, and they get to the Red Sea. فَلَمَّا تَرَى الْجَمْعَانِ, when the two groups saw one another, they could see one another. قَالَ أَصْحَابُ مُوسَى إِنَّا لَمُدْرَكُونَ, the people who followed Musa, their iman was obviously weak, they said, that's it, we're gone, they will catch up to us and they're going to kill us. Subhanallah, what did Musa say? In front of him is the Red Sea. Behind him is the mightiest army in the world. There is nowhere to go. There is no hope whatsoever, but there is hope. What does Musa say? قَالَ كَلَّا, he says, no, إِنَّ مَعِيَ رَبِّي سَيَهْدِينَ, I have my Lord with me. My Lord will guide me. Subhanallah, what iman do we have? Fir'aun behind you, the Red Sea in front of you, the people of Musa say, that's it, we're gone. But Musa says, don't worry, I have Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He shall put it. He didn't know what would happen. Musa did not know that the Red Sea would part, but he knew that Allah was on his side, and he had such trust in Allah. He said, I have my Lord, and my Lord is going to make a way out for me. So what happened? فَأَوْحَيْنَا إِلَيْهِ, we inspired Musa, that split, that strike the Red Sea with your staff. فَانْفَلَقَ, what a powerful word in the Quran, only occurs in this ayah. فَانْفَلَقَ, the falaq took place, the dawn broke out. In other words, فَانْفَلَقَ means that it literally split up in front of him, that the ocean literally split up in front of him. فَكَانَ كُلُّ فِرْقٍ كَالطَّوْدِ الْعَظِيمِ, every single section of the ocean was like a massive mountain. You have two mountains of water literally right in front of you. And so Musa comes through. Subhanallah, dear Muslim, don't you realize that the Lord that you worship is the Lord of Musa and Harun? Don't you realize that same Lord is the one who parted the Red Sea for Musa? That is my Lord and your Lord. Have a fraction of Musa's faith, you shall see a fraction of that miracle in your own life as well. Never lose hope. Allah is on your side. Then comes the story of Ibrahim alayhi salam, verses 69 to 105. And again, a beautiful story of Ibrahim and his father speaking with his people. And in it, this section, we have the dua of Ibrahim alayhi salam, verses 78 onwards, that الَّذِي خَلَقَنِي فَهُوَ يَهْدِينَ, he who created me and therefore will guide me. Notice, creation and guidance go hand in hand. Those who say, yeah, there must be some God and then he left us, they don't understand what a God is. How can a God create you and then not guide you? How can a God set up this perfect ecosystem, this perfect harmony and synthesization of everything around us, and then not tell us how to live? الَّذِي خَلَقَنِي فَهُوَ يَهْدِينَ, Ibrahim understood this. My God who created me and therefore he shall guide me, the one who feeds me and the one who gives me water, and when I fall sick, he is the one who heals me. Notice, he ascribes the sickness to himself and the healing to Allah, even though technically everything is from Allah, but we ascribe the evil to shaitan or to ourselves, and we ascribe the good to Allah. وَإِذَا مَرِضْتُ, when I fall sick, فَهُوَ يَشْفِينَ, he is the one who cures me, and he is the one who will cause me to die and resurrect me, and he is the one whom I hope shall forgive my sins. Notice, dying and resurrection is a fact. Forgiveness is not guaranteed. Even Ibrahim is saying, I hope that Allah will forgive me. رَبِّ هَبْ لِي حُكْمًا وَأَلْحِقْنِي بِالصَّالِحِينَ O my Lord, grant me wisdom and make me from amongst the righteous. وَجْعَلْ لِي لِسَانَ صِدْقٍ فِي الْآخِرِينَ These du'as, by the way, we want to memorize them. That's why I'm saying them. Memorize these du'as, read these du'as, and allow me to have a reputation of good amongst later people. You know, it's nothing wrong to have a positive reputation for the sake of Allah. Ibrahim wanted to have a good reputation. He wanted later progenies to admire him. And no human being in all of history is admired by larger groups than the Prophet Abraham, because Jews, Christians, Muslims, they all look up to him amongst the Abrahamic faith, as it is called. And so he is saying, Oh Allah, give me a positive reputation amongst later generations. And Allah gave him that. And make me of those who inherit the garden of bliss. And forgive my father, he was of those who was misguided. And do not disgrace me on the day of resurrection. وَلَا تُخْسِنِي يَوْمَ يُبْعَثُونَ يَوْمَ لَا يَنْفَعُ مَالٌ وَلَا بَنُونَ إِلَّا مَنْ أَتَى اللَّهَ بِقَلْبٍ سَلِيمٍ On that day, neither wealth nor children will help anyone except for he who comes to Allah with a pure heart. قَلْبٍ سَلِيمٍ Ibrahim is telling us in this dua the importance of a pure heart. What is a pure heart? A pure heart is a heart that is attached only to Allah and harbors no ill will against the creation of Allah. The pure heart is pure for Allah and it is pure for the creation of Allah. That pure heart, when it comes on the day of judgment, the wealth and money that the pure heart has will actually benefit. Notice the verse, يَوْمَ لَا يَنْفَعُ مَالٌ وَلَا بَنُونَ On that day, wealth and money will be of no value, but it will to one category, the one who comes to Allah with the قَلْبٍ سَلِيمٍ When's the last time you examined your spiritual heart? When's the last time you really did a deep introspection? You don't need to be a heart doctor to do that introspection. This is a spiritual disease, not the physical one. And only you can inspect yourself. Think about your own heart. Examine your own heart and think, what are the issues that I have? Is it jealousy? Is it anger? Is it hatred? Is it unresolved? This and that. Think about those things. First and foremost, between you and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and then between you and the creation, and then resolve them so that you have the qalb salim. You want the peaceful, pure heart so that you can come on the day of judgment and you will have all the benefits of this world and the next world benefiting you on the day of judgment. Also, that beautiful dua, وَلَا تُخْسِنِي يَوْمَ يُبْعَثُونَ Do not disgrace me, O Allah, on the day of resurrection. Subhanallah. أَوْذُ بِاللَّهِ That is the ultimate disgrace, to be disgraced by the Creator in front of all of the creation. There is no greater disgrace. We do not want to be disgraced. وَلَا تُخْسِنِي يَوْمَ يُبْعَثُونَ And if we don't want to be disgraced, then make sure we prepare and we don't embarrass ourselves, because any disgrace that happens, it will be because of what we ourselves have done. So again, beautiful dua for us to benefit from. After this comes the story of Nuh alayhi salam, 105 to 122. And the Prophet Nuh alayhi salam, again, so much benefit here, but here he is threatened by being stoned to death and he perseveres. So next time somebody makes a comment, gives you a slur, makes you a sarcastic remark, think of the Prophet Nuh. Compare what you're going through with your irritation with what they threatened Nuh alayhi salam, and take some comfort in that. Then follows the story of Hud, 124 to 140. And the Prophet Hud, he reminds his people of their magnificent buildings and their structures. He reminds them of all the blessings that Allah gave them that were not given to the previous generations. And when we read these verses, we should think of the blessings Allah has given us. We should think of the comforts that we have, of the amenities that, you know, the average person in our time has more amenities and privileges and ease of life than even Fir'aun and Qarun in the past, even the greatest multi-billionaire of the past. Our simple, you know, facts of technology and air conditioning and these basic things, our transportation that we have, these are luxuries that the greatest person 100,000 years ago did not have. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave it to us. We live lifestyles that would even make Fir'aun jealous in our daily mediocre our lives. Having a refrigerator with food that we can access at any time, cold water and ice, was a luxury that only the richest would have, and we can have it any time. These are basic amenities that the bulk of mankind has, and yet we take them for granted. And Hud is reminding his people that you have been blessed with things previous generations have not been blessed with. So thank Allah. Surely we should learn as well. We have been blessed in this generation with so many things that past generations have not been blessed with. We should be appreciative to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The next section, Prophet Salih, verses 141 to 159, that the Prophet Salih tells his people to beware of those who are musrifeen, those who are corrupting and telling people to go astray, who are corrupting in the lands, and don't follow those that are evil leaders. And again, subhanAllah, the majority of leaders, the majority of rich and powerful people, they give you falsehood so that you are misguided, because the truth is powerful to them. The truth destroys them. They don't want people to follow the truth. And therefore, the Prophet Salih is telling them that beware of those people that are misguiding you. They don't have your best interests in heart. The prophets come with your best interests. The prophets come to guide you. And the people of this world and the rich and the powerful, they want you to be sheep. They want you to be controlled so that they can continue living the way that they are living. So the Prophet Salih says, وَلَا تُطِعُوا أَمْرَ الْمُسْرِفِينَ. Do not obey, do not pay heed to those that are causing corruption and fitna and fasad, and those that are misguiding. The next section, the Prophet Lut, verses 160 to 175. The Prophet Lut, and again, we've done the Prophet Lut multiple times. And again, look here, the wisdom in how he is preaching his people. أَتَأْتُونَ الذُّكْرَانَ مِنَ الْعَالَمِينَ. Are you approaching other men? O men, are you approaching other men? That instead of going to your wives, you're approaching other men. Then he says to them, إِنِّي لِعَمَلِكُمْ مِنَ الْقَالِينَ. This action that you are doing, I dislike it. Notice here, when you are preaching to a group of people that are engaged in a sin, there is a wisdom in how you phrase it. He separates in this phrase the action from the actor. He separates the deed from the doer, because the goal is not to make the person hate you or feel bad. The goal is to make the person reform. How will you make the person reform if you're going to be preaching vulgarities and hatred? How will you have an impact if you're spouting negativities? SubhanAllah, so many of our fellow Muslims, may Allah guide us and them, so many of them, they don't understand wisdom. And when a person preaches with wisdom, they don't understand. And they're like, why aren't you preaching the truth? Here is Lut alayhi salam preaching the truth. And what is he saying when he's speaking to them? He is saying, this action of yours, I don't like it. I don't like the action. Why is he saying the action? Because he wants to separate them at this point. Obviously, at some level, there is no action without an actor. The doer and the doing has to go together. At the same time, the goal here is to reach out and try to guide them, to make them, to touch their hearts. You're not going to do that by being crude and mean and nasty. It doesn't work that way. This is not the methodology of the prophets. So let us learn wisdom when we're preaching and teaching. In our time, societies have changed. This deed, this action has now become mainstream, and people view it with a very different way. Okay, that's their view. We then, we're not going to change our theology. We're not going to change our usul, our paradigm, but we are obliged to preach with wisdom. And wisdom changes from culture to time to place. How you phrase and how you speak, it is a matter of wisdom. That's not, the Quran and Sunnah doesn't tell you specifics. It tells you, وَجَادِلْهُمْ بِالَّتِي هِيَ أَحْسَنَ. And that's what we said in a previous verse and here as well. The point being, the Prophet Lut is a role model for us, that when you preach, preach with wisdom. This is a very sensitive topic, and I have spoken about this in other lectures as well. So in any case, that's the Prophet Lut alayhi salam. The next section, the Prophet Shu'aib, and he reminds his people to act with qistas, with justice. By the way, in today's lecture, we gave two words that originated in Latin that the Arabs took and Arabicized, asatir and qistas. And they're both in the Surah Al-Furqan and Surah Ash-Shu'ara. And those Latin roots were also taken by the Romance languages and eventually by English. And so we adopted them, and we have history or story, and we have justice. So justice and qistas, they sound similar because they have the similar root. And history or asatir, they sound similar because they do have the similar root. Now obviously, the Quran does have words that are purely Arabic. It is 100% Arabic, but their origins are other civilizations. And then they come into Arabic, the Arabs adopt them, the Arabs Arabicize them, and they are fluent Arabic. And then the Quran comes and utilizes those words, such as the nature of any language if you study the history of languages, but that is a tangent we're not allowed to go into. Anyway, back to our story, and we're finishing up inshallah the story of Shu'aib we have done. So now we finish up the narrative here of Surah Ash-Shu'ara. That verse 192 onwards, we're finishing up that وَإِنَّهُ لَتَنْزِيلُ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ, that verily this is the revelation of the Lord of the worlds, that angel Jibreel himself came down with upon your heart, so that you can be of the warners in a clear Arabic language. And then comes verse 214. And this verse is the command for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to go public with Islam. وَأَنذِرْ عَشِيرَتَكَ الْأَقْرَبِينَ. When this verse came down, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam stopped being private or secretive. The word private is better, not secretive. He was private about the da'wah for the first 2 years. Then he went public. When did he go public? When Surah Ash-Shu'ara came down. So this surah is a very early Meccan one, and this verse, وَأَنذِرْ عَشِيرَتَكَ الْأَقْرَبِينَ, was the verse that caused him to call his family members, all of the extended tribes. He called them and he then told them that he is a prophet because of this verse, verse 214. And Allah Azza wa Jal then says, وَتَوَكَّلْ عَلَى الْعَزِيزِ الرَّحِيمِ. SubhanAllah. Throughout the entire surah, 7 or 8 times after every one of these stories, between every story, Allah is saying, and indeed your Lord is Azizur Rahim. Learn from this that there are many signs for this. Now it comes to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he is being told all of these stories, look at them, and Al-Aziz Al-Rahim took care of them. Now it's your turn, Ya Rasulullah. Put your trust in the Aziz and the Rahim, the one who dealt with all of the previous prophets and their rejectors. Now you are, it's your turn, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will deal with your rejectors. And this is the whole motif throughout the entire surah. And then this surah concludes by criticizing one category of mankind. Verse 224. وَالشُّعَرَاءُ يَتَّبِعُهُمُ الْغَاوُونَ, that the poets, they are followed by those who are lost. Those who are lost, they follow them. Don't you see? They're wandering in every valley and they're advising people to do things that they themselves do not do. Except for those poets who believe and who do good deeds and remember Allah frequently. And so the surah concludes by a criticism of the majority of poets and then takes out one category of poets. And this is a much deeper topic, but very briefly, and then we are done for today, that the whole concept of poetry and arts and entertainment, the Quran is saying that, look, if it is done properly, by the right people, for the right purposes, yeah, there's some good in there. But historically speaking, let's be honest here, most of the people associated with such industries, they are as the Quran describes. They themselves are lost and they're leading the lost. They don't have anywhere to go. They don't have a concrete goal. They just speak. The meaning wandering in every valley means wandering without a goal. They're just going here, going there, going. They're living for the moment. They don't have a higher purpose there. And so the point is that, you know, this whole industry by poetry, we mean all types of entertainment, that Allah says, generally speaking, it is not an industry that is wholesome, that is conducive, that will benefit you. But yes, within it, إِلَّا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ وَذَكَرُوا اللَّهَ كَثِيرًا. If there are people there that utilize it in a proper manner, and they themselves are righteous and pious, then yes, indeed, some things can be done. And of course, our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he would listen to good poetry, and he had a poet, Hassan ibn Thabit, who used poetry to defend Islam. And so yes, all of these arts, they can be and they should be employed for the benefit of a higher cause and to defend and protect Islam. But let's be honest as well, that is a dangerous territory, because all of this also has that which is a waste of time, that which is hypocritical, that which is a hardening of the heart, that which doesn't have a higher purpose. They wander in every valley, and the people that are lost, they follow them. Meaning, entertainment is just living for the time. You waste time without doing anything, and that's not very healthy. So again, the Quran is very beautiful. beautiful and is describing the overall and then making that exception. If anybody is involved in that industry, let them be amongst the exception so that inshaAllah ta'ala they can be of the Hassan ibn Thabits of our time. InshaAllah ta'ala tomorrow we'll be doing the next three surahs, not just two, and we'll be doing three surahs for the next few days. May Allah Azza wa Jal give us all iman and ikhlas and taqwa and cause us to die upon the kalima of La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah. Until then, salamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu.
شهر رمضان الذي أنزل فيه القرآن هدى للناس وبينات من الهدى والفرقان فمن شهد منكم الشهر فليصم ومن كان مريضا أو على سفر فعدة من أيام أخر يريد الله بكم اليسر ولا يريد بكم العسر ولتكملوا العدة ولتكبروا الله على ما هداكم ولعلكم تشكرون.